Hey YouTubers, and welcome to this TFD and the giveaway for the Isotek power supply. So there's a few little things we're going to cover off before the actual giveaway, which I'll go through quickly. I'll have a quick chat about my Butterfly Labs Bitcoin miner. There's a little miner issue there to talk about. Again, battery testing, a bit to chat about there. I've got the lithium iron phosphate battery here, which we're going to look and open up at some point in time, but I'll talk about that. And then I have a bottle of this Buckeye from Cleveland beer, and you'll see it's got a Martian on the front of it. So that was Chris Gammel's little joke. He came around for supper with his wife this weekend and he bought me this beer. Very nice, big thank you to him. But what I want to talk about is perhaps having, I know Chris has shown interest in doing a video together with me in terms of talking about some technical bits and pieces, because he is a well-versed gent in terms of technical topics related to measurement. But I thought it'd be good to get a good background on Chris, because he does come from a very good technical background and he's worked for some very interesting companies. So before he does an actual technical perhaps chat or presentation on something, we'll hear about his background and how that's brought him to where he is today. I also would like that to perhaps lead into further conversations on what it takes to perhaps become an entrepreneur. Now, if you do kind of leave the safety confines of being employed and decide to start your own business and become an entrepreneur, there can be many, many challenges and many things you have to understand. So, and the one thing is learning to accept and deal with failure. And failure often potentially is going to make you a better entrepreneur, because you're going to learn from your mistakes. If you can get up from them, dust yourself off and move on, you potentially become a better business owner and an entrepreneur. And all those kind of learning lessons and the things you can learn while you're employed, in particular, if you're employed and you want to get out of permanent employment, there are a lot of life lessons that you can learn there to prepare you for literally jumping out and doing your own thing. So perhaps chatting to Chris, and perhaps I can talk a bit about going to more in depth about my career and how that prepared me to kind of move away from permanent employment. And hopefully that'll provide interesting lessons for those of you considering doing the same thing. Right, so let's jump into and just quickly discuss my Bitcoin miner. Now, first of all, you'll know I did the Bitcoin mining video some time ago, where I chatted, gave a basic rundown of what Bitcoin mining is all about, and then gave an intro into Bitcoin mining on CPUs, GPUs, ASICs, and FPGAs. Now, my little Bitcoin miner has been chugging along all that time. It has more than paid for itself already. When I did that video, I think the price of Bitcoin was around 250, 270 odd. I forget the exact figure. It has been now hovering around $1,000 per Bitcoin for quite a while. That has kind of happened. As I said, there were many reasons why Bitcoin could potentially fail, because it may be pursued as an illegitimate currency by governments and banks. But banks and even the US government have actually given a kind of a warm backing to the idea of a virtual currency, and that seems to have strengthened it, as well as apparently the Chinese buying up a lot of Bitcoin. So the price has just gone up, 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 and has stayed there. And so even though the difficulty level has increased and I'm only mining a very small piece of Bitcoin every few weeks, that small piece of Bitcoin is now worth a fair bit of money. However, I went and stuck this in a cupboard to reduce the noise in the surrounding area here. And I was conscious that putting it in a cupboard, it's a fairly big cupboard behind my desk, that obviously heat might be an issue, but I put it in there and I kept an eye on it and heat wasn't an issue. However, what happened at some point in time is the fan failed. Now, whether again that was because it was in the cupboard or it was because, remember, I opened this up, who knows, but the fan failed. And I couldn't understand. I then took it out and I hadn't realized the fan wasn't working, because it would still fire up, it still connect, still mint, but eventually it would disconnect because the temperature is getting too high. And that's when I realized something was awry. So I'm going to open this up off camera and try and sort it out. If it is a really interesting fix, then I'll certainly film it and let you know. So the next thing I want to talk about is the battery testing. I mentioned the results of some of my battery testing, and I've now got a gel battery alongside my lead crystal battery under test. Some people noted that the damage, I might not have damaged this battery per se because the cells might be just unbalanced. Even though I had taken it down to zero and brought it back up again, and only after a few of those cycles, it was producing basically only half of its rated capacity. Now, what I want to highlight is, although it might not be damaged, for the general user, a battery like this, which is sealed and only got two connections over here, for all intents and purposes, it is damaged, because the general public is not going to be able to go into this to see whether the cells are unbalanced. I have just quickly tried to pry the top open with a screwdriver, and it certainly doesn't come off easily. So what I intend to do, because I'm now very intrigued, for one, to see if I can get in and see if the cells can be recovered because they've been unbalanced or whether it is actually damaged. So that's the one exercise. And then two, to see if there is any protection circuitry in here. So remember I spoke and said there supposedly is protection circuitry inside here. Perhaps it failed or something went awry, or perhaps there's just none and the marketing of this is actually totally misquoting what is in here. So I will open this up obviously very carefully because it could be potentially dangerous opening something like this. I wouldn't recommend it. And we'll have a look inside this to see if it can be recovered. Now, a further note, and I know I keep on going on about the lead crystal batteries. I then put it on another cycle again after I removed that. And what I noticed, it had moved up from its like 94 capacity, taking it down to zero and back up. It had moved up to like 96, then 97, and now it's at 105% of its capacity. And I thought, what's going on? So I had a closer look, and what had happened when I started this cycling again, I'd made a slight adjustment to the charge profile, and mistakenly I'd increased just by a point of a volt, increased the bulk charge level. And I've been taking that up to 14.7 volts as opposed to the 14.4. Now, potentially that can be very dangerous when you start overcharging batteries like that, so you have to be very careful. As you know, I've got it in a safe with a fire alarm system, with a fire extinguisher. But nonetheless, it is now producing over its rated capacity. So I'm now going to set it back to its normal upper limit, because through seven cycles it hasn't damaged it, has been producing over 100% of its rated capacity. I'm going to take it back so I'm not overcharging it to still see how it operates. Now, if you go to, and again, because my time is limited, I managed to get to the Better Battery site. Better Battery is the company that produces these lead crystal batteries. And I'll put a link below. And if you go there, there is a specification or a performance tab on the actual home screen. And if you go and have a look at that, it'll give you a comparison of the lead crystal batteries versus other technologies. And the one thing they say, and I know this is probably going to rattle one or two of you in particular, is that you can actually get more cycles out of it than you can the lithium technologies. So that is certainly interesting. I'm going to try and communicate with Better Batteries to see if I can get another sample battery again to make sure what I'm doing isn't just a once-off or a fluke. But so far, I've tested multiple batteries alongside it. Everything so far is either failed or got to the point where it's not producing most of its rated capacity, and the lead crystal still soldiers on and is doing well. Right, so what I'll do soon, as I say, coming back to the beer bottle, is I will tap Chris on the shoulder. We are having another meetup tonight. I will put the details below. I know it might be late for some of you, but we have them once a month. We meet up at a pub. You can bring along your electronics projects or just come along and meet a host of very interesting people. And then tonight when I'm there, what I'll do is I'll have a chat to Chris and I'll arrange a time for him to come in on the T4D. And he can be the first person perhaps who comes in. We have a chit chat to understand his background and how he's got to where he has. I know Chris is doing very well with his contextual electronics course. So if you do want to be part of that or part of future courses, then certainly go to Chris's site, contextualelectronics.com, and follow what he's doing there. Right, so time to do the draw for the Isotech power supply. So first off, a big thank you to Paolo of Isotech for providing the prize, the Isotech power supply. Also, thanks to all of you for entering. There's over 40 of you who have entered for that competition. The other competition, the first prize of the oscilloscope and the Arduino kit for the electronic design part, that'll happen in early February. So certainly wrap that up and get your designs posted. For this competition, what I've done, I've gone and noted down, I've gone and quickly handwritten down all the entrants from both the Google Plus site and obviously my forum. I've gone and written down the forum name, if the country is displayed, the origin of the person who entered, and then if they happen to have publicly noted their real name, I've noted that as well. For the most part, I might not be able to pronounce the name, so I'll do my best or spell it out. You'll have to excuse that. The entries come from all over the world. It's nice to see a fairly good balance. They're not, the bulk of them aren't from the States. There's a few from the States, but there's a mix of Germany, Netherlands, Austria, Australia, Israel, India, Philippines, Ireland, England, Poland, and a whole lot from Romania. Certainly seems to be a lot of interest in electronics in Romania. Right, so what I'm going to do, I've got all of these numbered down on the sheet. So everyone has a unique number. I've got my Isotek IPS303DD power supply here. And then I've got the new Isotek IDM505 multimeter. So I thought I'd try and rig it up so this could be involved in picking the number. So I've got it set to its 100,000 count. So we've got four digits after the comma. And then I've got it set to its auto hold mode. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to twiddle the knob on my power supply, then let it settle, and the meter will then obviously stop. And as long as it stops on the last two digits is what we're going to use. So the last two digits, as long as it's showing a value between 1 and 41 or into the 40s, that'll be the number that wins, and then I'll read off the sheet who that is. So I'll just bring you in a little bit closer to have a look at that. Right, so here we go. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to do a dry run first just so you can see how it works. So on the Isotek, which I will do a full review on soon, I've got it set to its high resolution. As you can see, we've got four digits after the comma. What it's doing in its auto hold mode, once it gets a stable reading, it'll then lock on and display that in the secondary display. So I'll just bring you in a little bit closer so you can see that. So that is the secondary display where it's going to auto hold or auto lock on a stable reading. And it's those last two digits, as long as they are below 41, we will use to pick out the winner. So I'll go through a dry run. What I'm going to do, I'm just going to twiddle the knob on my power supply. And I will then let it stabilize. Bang. And then it's locked. And there we go. It's locked on number 17. So that's what we're going to do. So it'll be that first lock. Sometimes literally if the reading has changed, it might go and stabilize and lock again. But it's that first beep. And what it locks on is the number that I'll choose and read off the winner. So let's go. Let's spin the dial. So I'm going to go on the fine voltage, spin it around. Good old spin. Let's hope it's below. No, it's not going to be 75, too high. Try again. Spin again. 40. My goodness. Okay. 40 is our winner. And if I go to my sheet, right. So this was a late entry into the competition. And on my sheet, I'll read off my Torrid writing, but it's F-R-O-E-S-E, and that's from the UK. So that's the person on my forum. So they can either email me, but I'll certainly get hold of them. F-R-O-E-S-E from the UK. So congratulations for entering and winning the prize. Right, so again, congratulations to the gent from the UK. F-R-O-E-S-E is his ID on my forum. I will obviously make contact with you. I'll get your address and then I'll arrange shipping the power supply off to you. Again, thanks to everyone for sending in the pictures of your workbenches. I know a lot of people are commenting and saying, well, here's my bench, it's very simple and the power supply would be great. It doesn't matter if you've got a simple workbench, we all start off somewhere. So it's great to see the different workbenches and the way people work in what you entered in this competition. So again, just a reminder to the folks who are doing the design project, just reread what I've noted needs to be done for the competition if you're entering for the oscilloscope and the Arduino, and that will literally be in the first or the second week of February that I draw for that. And I'll post a note on my forum noting when it's cut off. But I imagine, as I say, it's almost too late for anyone to enter new for that competition. And there aren't going to be too many people in that competition. And as I said, I'll allow a few folks on my forum and perhaps Paolo to be the judges of that competition. And then I'll announce the winner in early February. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.